Well, I guess we'll start. It's 11 o'clock. So, well, welcome. Very nice to see a lot of people again. Probably some of you already know me. I've been talking at Tito's for a couple of years now. And today we're gonna talk about something that's happening within the healthcare system. If you thought Jeroen, the previous speaker, had a couple of a list of some problems, I'm gonna add another one. Who am I? Maurice Verhezen. I'm an electrical and industrial engineer. Recently I started my own company called Data Computing. We solve data analysis problems for researchers in the private and public sector. And I'm also in the Netherlands the coordinator of the Free Software Foundation Europe. And this presentation is a bit in between of both, because it's something that has to do with free software and it's something that has to do with the company that I recently started. Okay, what if we look at healthcare? There are two things happening. The trend is that people should get more included in their own health situation. Right now you go to a doctor and the doctor has a lot of information about you, and yeah, you just have to follow the things that he or she says and comes up with. And the trend is that we are trying to, let's just say, commercialize healthcare and make the patients have more choice, make you have more choice about your health and your healthcare. On the other side, there's the research into diseases, into healthcare. The trend there is that we would love to see more access for researchers to health data, because right now they have to ask permission for everything, and a lot of data just isn't available at all. They just can't reach it, or it's in the wrong format, or it's in different hospitals, or it's in different institutes, and they just can't access it at all. So we need to find a way that reconciles both of these threats. And in that game, right now, we're already two steps behind. Is my view. That has to do with the way the discussion within the healthcare system and the people that are doing the research and healthcare providers are thinking about privacy, are thinking about the technology that is needed to actually build to build systems that deal with these two threats. One of the things I'm involved in is the health RI, the health research infrastructure that is right now being built in the Netherlands, or at least is going to be built at some point. And this is about the discussion. This is how it looks. These are all the parties involved. And where do you think the patient is? Now you probably think right here somewhere where the little figures are. Well, in my view, they're actually not. They're here, because I think if you look at what a patient or person is in a digital form, then we're talking about data. You're just a line in a database. Your numbers. So where the numbers are stored is actually where the patients are. And that's where I focus on in when I'm discussing this with the healthcare providers and with the people in who are actually thinking up this stuff, to make them understand that you need to focus on that privacy issue. And that is where the personal locker is situated as well. I'm going to explain in this presentation what my vision would be of a personal locker, a locker where you can store your personal health data, because right now it's stored in very interesting places. So instead of looking at putting the patient central, the patient should be central, but what we're talking about is actually the data. And of course, a lot of people already realize this. One of those companies is MRDM, and what they have built is a kind of connection with all the electronic health records systems, of nearly all the electronic health record systems in the Netherlands. 73% of Dutch hospitals is already connected, so they have a connection right into the electronic health system of 73% of the hospitals, and they have, of course, customers, like, for instance, the insurance companies, where, yeah, well, they pay for access to that data. And that's, to me, it's strange, because it's not the researchers, it's actually other people that have access to this data. Another example, this is a slide from an Apple presentation, and it was about healthcare, and what you need to look at is this right here. This is our Radboud UMC, a Dutch universal medical hospital. And they are doing quite some interesting stuff with data. They have their EHR system is right now being coupled with Apple's health infrastructure. And next to that, they have a deal with Philips, which places all your medical data at Salesforce.com in the US. Yeah, well, I don't have to explain to you that that's not a great idea. So instead of actually giving patients control over their data, we are putting them in places where they actually don't have control anymore, because it's overseas, it's in some sort of cloud, it's gone. So why is this a problem? Well, first of all, it's a security problem. And now it gets interesting. Because who is after that data? It's actually hackers, which is, yeah, crackers, I should say, here in this room, who are after your who are after the data to somehow extort it or get your public burger service number, your social security number, which is stored usually within EHR systems. So that's very valuable, because you can do a lot of stuff with that. So they are actually focusing on that kind of data for money, but also governments. And governments are much more interesting to look at. They make a funny story, and they want influence, because if you know a lot of stuff about the health or any information about people, you can actually do certain things to them. And they actually have a system for that. This is one of the emails that got released. It's one of the cables that got released a couple of years ago, where the state secretary, so the foreign Buitenlandse Zaken, Secretary of State, asked all of the embassies for information about stuff that is happening within the country that they are situated. And this is a normal way of doing business. Probably every country in the world does this. So what happens is, somewhere in the US, in the political system or in service, somebody has a question, in this case about Romania. What they do is they send this to some central place. So I want to know this and this about people in Romania or a certain person in Romania. And then all these questions are gathered, and they are prioritized, and then they are sent to the embassies to gather that information. And this is such a request. And what's interesting, this is absolutely top secret. This is one of the things that just got caught up in WikiLeaks. And it's not for, it says no foreign. That means no foreign nationals. And what they are asking here, I'll read it out loud because there's a complete list about all the things that they want to know about people in Romania. But right here at point number 4A, they are asking for reporting and collection needs about the national leadership and governance. Well, there's a whole lot of stuff that they want from the national leaders, but especially the health and biometric information about current and emerging leaders and advisors. So these are the current leaders and advisors of Romania, where they want health and biometric data. So let this sink in. There's an official request from a government who is after your health data. And the funny thing is that they also say emerging leaders. So if you have a child and you want to make sure that they can end up in government or be an advisor to a government, maybe you shouldn't be starting with quantified self of your child, because that's, I think, a problem. Because what do they do with these with this information when they have this? They can actually distort negotiations. And that's the influence that they're after. They want to do this kind of stuff, what happened in Copenhagen. And where does this information come from? Well, it comes from the, this is a Snowden slide, it comes from Google, Yahoo, Facebook, the whole bunch, and they have been doing this for years. And I think now we can add the to the list, of course, Salesforce, Apple, and Philips, who are working with all that health data. Because it's really strange that we are storing, we are now bringing our health data without any question to the United States, who we know is after our health data. And that's to me, it's just, it's incredible, because there's a legal means for the government in the US to actually access that data. And we actually know this, because this is the Safe Harbor Agreement that was nullified, so we actually are not allowed to store stuff like this in the US cloud for especially these kinds of reasons. And the new legislation that has been made is not that much better than the Safe Harbor Agreement was. So that's a bad thing. And if you think it's going to get better, well, we all know that this guy is in office right now, and he puts America first. So where do you think our privacy concerns are gonna end up? So we need some basic information security, conveniently called CIA. Everybody probably in this room knows this. It stands for confidentiality, integrity, and availability. The confidentiality is who can access your data, so think about encryption, that kind of stuff. Integrity is about who's the data from, that you know that for sure, and if that you know that the data is maybe altered, or that you are sure that it's unaltered. And availability is that you actually can access the data that you need at the right time. So how I think about what we should do with the data storage of our health records. I think the patient should be in control. They should be allowed to share data with the doctors and the researchers that they would like. I think you should actually legally own your data. That's also a bit murky, because when you are uploading it through an app on your iPhone, and it goes to this health system of Apple, and it ends up in some database somewhere, is it still your data, or are they building a database of health data which they actually own? So that's a big discussion, especially also in the Netherlands. It's not per se that the information you are that is being stored in a hospital about you is actually that's actually not owned by you. There's an interesting thought there. And of course, you need to protect it technically. And I think you should have that data nearby. It shouldn't be in a cloud. You should have the choice to put it somewhere where you live. So what do I think a personal locker of your health records should look like? I think it should be part of that larger research network. So it should be able to couple with that network, so you are able to actually share your data with researchers, which they can benefit from, but also you benefit from because they make better medicine. I think it should be a set of standards, open quality standards, about how to store, collect, share the data so that everybody can implement it. And maybe the personal locker should be the reference implementation if we're talking about something physical that we're going to produce. And for me, the thing is a box that you have at home, just like your set-top box from an ISP, a box that you have at home where you can point to and say, okay, there's my data. It's encrypted, it's redundant because it has a distributed file system, and it's right there. And you can control access to it via a website that is running on that device. So you don't have to log into some sort of portal from Philips or whatever to change the control settings, but it's actually there on your own local area network. And it's part of that bigger research network, so other people can actually send, for instance, an analysis to your device, and then the analysis that the researcher wants to do is actually running on your device, or you can allow it to actually copy the data to the researcher site, and you can control this for almost for everything that you would like. So a physical box at home, maybe at your general practice office, because then it's even more protected, because if huisarts in Dutch, in general practitioner, is actually maintaining that box, then it's protected by the client, how do you say, the geheimhoudingsplicht in ieder geval. And so you can make a choice. You can either have it at home or maybe at your GP's office. For authorization, why don't we do that with blockchain? So the when you share something, that's actually a contract between you and your doctor. Authentication, there are all kinds of new authentication mechanisms that are being built right now, like that protect privacy a bit more, like IRMA or the Key Foundation, which has an interesting offer on that. And like I said, storage, it should be, of course, available all the time. So a box at home, that's a bit difficult, but if you make it distributed, all the boxes in your neighborhood actually replicate your data, but since the data is encrypted, you can still make sure that it's safe and it's nearby. So that's my vision of the personal locker that we should build, because it's not here. It's not here yet. And that has a couple of benefits. If we look at the information security, from an information security point, instead of having it in the US cloud where the US can actually access it, it'll be at home encrypted. In Tracketree, you actually have now some safeguards because through blockchain or things like key, you can actually make sure that it's that the data is unaltered, and that you can be sure that you are the only one that can access it, or you and the researcher. Availability, Do we want to store all our information in electronic health record systems and in cloud somewhere, or do we actually want to have it closer at home that we can actually control it? So that was the first thing that was wrong with it, security. And now we're going to talk about lock-in, just a couple of minutes. How am I doing time? Okay. Yeah. Well, lock-in. Of course, the reason that these companies are doing this is because they want that data. They want you to store the data in their clouds, because then they can ask money for it, for the servers to have that data. And they will store it not for 2 years or 5 years, but they will store it for the rest of your life. So they are after that lock-in. They are after that buy-in from customers, that you put your all the data in one place. And well, you know me, I like free software and open standards, and I think we should actually build this stuff on these principles to make sure that this lock-in is impossible, that there is a business model there, that you actually service, that everybody can build a service to store this data, but it shouldn't be completely controlled by these companies. I think we should come up with the standards and the APIs and the stuff to make sure that this stuff stays free, and that you actually have a choice. I mean, a lot of people don't care about this. They're just probably going to store everything in some cloud somewhere. But for the people who do care about where their data is stored, I think we should have a good alternative. I'm going to skip this because I was giving this talk 2 days ago at one of the Health RI meetings, and there I still had to explain what free software is, but I guess all of you already know. So, further work. Right now what I'm doing is gathering groups of people that are already built part of this solution that I'm talking about. Because, of course, the whole idea is actually based on pretty much what Eben Moglen said a couple of years ago, the freedom box, a thing at home where your social network lives. I'm working with actually a couple of organizations and people that are already having parts of the solution. But I hope that a lot of other people will join and just make sure that we get this thing off the ground, because I think it's extremely important. There's a real big chance that all our data is gonna, or all our health data is really gonna end up pretty quickly in one of the in clouds. And I think there should really be an alternative. So I would ask all of you just to somehow get involved, contact me. Let's talk about this. If you have any other ideas about how this thing could be even better, or how it could be presented, or anything that you, any ideas that could help this idea further are very much welcome. That's it. I would love to hear from you right now. Any questions?